Adequate notice of this meeting has been given in accordance with the Open Public Meetings Act pursuant to Public Laws 1975, Chapter 231. This agenda is complete to the extent known and was sent to the Trenton Times and the Trentonian newspapers, posted on the first floor board in the City Hall, and filed in the City Clerk's office. Formal action will be taken. Roll call, clerk.
Mr. Blakely.
Present.
Ms. Colwell Wilson.
Present.
Mr. Harrison. Mr. Michelle.
Present.
Mr. Rodriguez.
Present.
Ms. Vaughn.
Present.
Ms. McBride.
Present.
First on the agenda for this evening, is the invocation and flag salute. Everybody please stand. Almighty God, who knows the fate of man and nation, we most humbly beseech thee to bless this our city, these deliberations, and these thy servants, that they may act with wisdom and understanding for the good of our community and thy greater glory. Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Members of the governing body and the audience, their reports on the agenda for this evening is a presentation by the 6th Regiment United States Colored Troops with Locust Hill and the restoration of Locust Hill Cemetery. First, I'd like to acquaint you with a little bit of the history of the Locust Hill Project. I grew up in Trenton, and of course spent a lot of time in East Trenton. And talking to the elders around here, they would always talk about the graveyard. Now, I'm not quite aware of what exactly they were talking about on Hart Avenue, because all I could see was a backyard, somebody's backyard. It didn't look like a graveyard at all. So I never was clear on exactly what this graveyard everybody was referencing was located when I grew up here. Later on, I was doing some voter registration on Hart Avenue, and I knocked on number 73. And I met Ms. Ethel Wilkins, who was a resident at that point, and spent some time chatting with her about the issues of the neighborhood. She pointed out that her backyard was a graveyard, and that the city had been ignoring it was in pretty bad shape, and that something needs to be done about that. And I carried that message back to the city council, in fact, pointing that out a number of years ago. It had been part of the Lord in Trenton that in that graveyard they would occasionally find bones and other things in that yard, and people regarded it as haunted for that reason. Moving forward in time, the question was put forward to City Council, can we do something about fixing the graveyard? And word came back that that's not a graveyard. It's not on the city tax rolls as a graveyard. But as they started digging, they found that it was a digging listed in 1945 as the Locust Hill Cemetery. And so the city of Trenton had to support employed a commission to do a further study on this Locust Hill graveyard. And in fact, it did something called a Mazer Report. And this did a historical documentary study of that property. It went way back until 1890. And they found that indeed there was a graveyard there. And it was on the tax rolls all the way up to 1945. Doing some further research with the Trentoniana collection, we actually found some pictures from that time. And we also found the tax records from that era. It was originally next to, I'm sure you're aware of, the Quaker Friends House on Hanover Street and West Montgomery, the Quaker Friends House there. Next to that was the Locust Hill Cemetery that was operated by, wasn't Locust Hill at that time, it was a Mount Zion Church Cemetery. And the property was actually sold, and the people who were interned there were moved to Locust Hill. And it was operated at the Locust Hill Cemetery for nearly 100 years. In the late 20s, all of the people from the Mount Zion Church who had operated had passed away. And nobody took direct ownership of it because the records had been lost when the Mount Zion Church itself had been. And so it became neglected. And I did find several newspaper stories associated with the Mazer Report that show that it was mentioned every few periodically as a black graveyard there on Hart Avenue. The Mount Zion Church doesn't have their records from that period. We've asked them about it, and they just simply lost some of the records from the early period of the graveyard. But fortunately, we were able to reconstruct much of the evidence that the Locust Hill Cemetery, in fact, existed there. So the complete scan, well, isn't really a graveyard. Stand if you would come and look first. The City of Trenton Commission, a company called Enviro Scan. And what they do is use what's called ground penetrating radar. They're going to shoot radar into the ground and see reflections. And here is a poster done by a virus scan that shows they have reflections in this area. The interesting thing is that at between six and 8 feet, they found linear rows of disturbed earth consistent with graveyard. You can see there, that was, as far as they're concerned, consistent with graves at the 6 foot level, and only which is 6 foot under. At 6 feet, we found this line of reflections that covered the next one, the next day. We found a line of reflections that were consistent with the turnings. So now we have documentary evidence and scientific firsthand evidence. This area here is where Enviro Scan reports that they found evidence of interments and graves. So we have scientific evidence, documentary evidence, that Hart Avenue Locust Hill Cemetery was there. In the reading years, the city designated as a graveyard. In fact, they purchased, what used to be a bus repair terminal that was at the end of Hart Avenue and demolished it. They found certain hot spots of pollution there and wanted to clean it up. But now the entire area from 73 Hart Avenue to the Assateague Creek has been cleared of buildings and is ready to be restored as a cemetery. Last year, the city of Trenton did in fact put up a fence that covered about half of the area that they designated as a graveyard. There's still some removal to be done of trees and other things that are occurring there, but these are things that are going to go forward in the future with the city's council support. And I want to emphasize that the East Trenton community has been working on this project 20 to 25 years. They've known all the time that this was a graveyard, and they pushed and nudged and worked, and in fact, they have a local skill graveyard committee that functions within the East Trenton Collaborative, and they've been meeting for a very, very long time. Steve Donner, they asked Six Regiment to act as the lead nonprofit organization as they pursued various state and federal grants to help them restore the Locust Hill Cemetery. And we got Steve Donner to do so because the Mesa report also turned up the fact that there was between 76 and 94 people buried there. And between 10 and 14 of the names you have are United States Colored Troops from the city of Trenton, veterans of the Civil War who are buried there. So it's a natural fit for us to be able to recognize the contribution of those soldiers and make sure that they are looked at in the level they deserve for their service to the United States. So, I would like to make sure that whatever attention comes to this project, that it falls squarely on the people of the neighborhood who worked so hard for so many years to make this come forward. If we're able to assist them in any way, we're glad to do it. And because we feel that's part of our mission to tell a story of African American soldiers. We applied for first round of grants with New Jersey Commission for Humanities, what they call a incubation grant or a planning grant. And we were successful in getting a grant. We had to be given $5,000 in order to do the planning for the story in the Locust Hill Cemetery. And so doing, the president word up and down and for lack of a better term, we're able to demonstrate and even support widespread union support for this particular area. We met with the citizens and committees at the East Trenton Ward, East Trenton Collaborative on more than one occasion. We had three community meetings with them where this was the main topic of discussion. And we had breakout sessions, and they were happy with what the grant they were putting forward was proposing. And we were successful. So much so that part of the support, we were recognized by Senator Turner, Senator Reynolds Jackson, and Senator Morelli with a General Assembly citation for the work we did. Again, this is a letter of support from Senator Turner personally. Brian Hughes, Mercer County, he thanks us for doing the work on the cemetery. He sends a letter of congratulations as well. Our representative in Congress, Fonda Watson Coleman, aware of our efforts, she sent a letter of congratulations as well. Berlina sent a personal letter of her own. Finally, there was a joint citation by the Senate and the General Assembly recognizing the work that we did on the cemetery. So I guess the point I'm meeting is that this is a project that enjoys widespread support throughout the community, by the residents, by the elected officials, and by the nonprofit community itself. In that, we part of the planning grants that we were able to commission an overall site design that was done by Clark Caton Heights. The architecture group of Clark Caton Heights brought an overall design that looked at the reason why I'm showing you this one is that the city of Trenton has always been working along with DEP and the county on the Assateague Greenway project. This is the Assateague Greenway, and the city has been working for 30 years on restoring the Assateague Greenway and the walkway beside it. And they envisioned the Lower Hill Cemetery as being, yes, sir. Greenway project, the Locust Hill Cemetery has always been envisioned as being part of that overall project. Unfortunately, in our planning plan, we were able to get the overall design plan accomplished. This is the early version of the city of Trenton desire. The next one is there. This is better. I have one with a better road. So the next one. That's a better look at the design itself. A blown up version of the same thing. If you'll note near the top, the red building is probably in your handout as well. You'll see a red building, that's 73 Park Avenue with the next to the parking lot. And that's where we intend to put what's called an interpretive center. Fancy way of saying it in the museum. This is going to be a black museum that's going to talk about the lives of the people who are buried in the Lower Hill Cemetery. It's also intended to be used as a venue for lectures and other educational programming that's going to be part of the overall Black historic tourism effort that underway in the city of Trenton. Also in the impact of the plan, you'll see a survey that was distributed to all of the residents on Oak Park Avenue and Oak Street and Taylor Street. So these are the people who are immediately affected by whatever work is done there. We passed out 87 surveys. We got back about 10%. Self-invested and biblical, but still, you know, we're also sitting online. But the important part is 100% of the surveys they gave back came back in support of the project. And that, likewise, at the community meeting with the press, I think, well, at the community meeting where the proposal was given to the community to consider, again, unanimous support for the project as envisioned thus far from the community at large. And I'm very proud to say that because we want to be sure that whatever we do is to the liking of the people who are going to be most affected by it. Now, although Mr. Capasso isn't here tonight, he was part of our development team. In fact, the development team, I guess I should spell it out. It's the 6th Red 59 States Color Group, it's the East Trenton Collaborative, it's the City of Trenton, Isles, 1804 Historical Consultants, and Williamson Law Firm. From those people, we formed a team with everybody playing a different role on the team. I was named the project director because I could sign documents related to the situation. And that project team has been awesome in their support. One of the things that came out of our meetings was that the city of Trenton not only wants to restore the Locust Hill project, they want to move forward with the demolition of the abandoned houses on the very end of Hart Avenue. They want to do streetscape. They want to do landscape along the Manhattan Green Greenway, and there was a serious discussion with them about how to accomplish that. Another thing we found is that the end of Hart Avenue has cobblestones, which means the blacktop. And we'd love to be able to scrape that blacktop off and keep those cobblestones exposed, so it's going to enhance the ambiance that this is a historic place, this is a distinct place, Locust Hill, here at the end of Hart Avenue. So the last part is that part of what we did on the in the planning grant was to ask Dr. Stevens and Dr. Linda Caldwell-Pess to compose a programming guide about where this should go. And they were able to produce, by that in your packet, a kind of an overall scheme for how to develop the project, what kind of programs should go in there, how you can use the particular effort there. One of the things they pointed out is this would be on the National Historic Register of Historic Places. And we're looking at that. But there's advantages, disadvantages, but it seems to me if it's designated as a historic site, that it's going to make it easier for us to move forward with applying for capital grants from the state. So we'll be doing that, and we'll also be contracting with the, by the way, I meant to mention the Garden School. They've also been part of the work that was done over there. In fact, they had an ongoing program cleaning up the Locust Hill Cemetery. So they are also part of what we do. So we have all the stakeholders on board, and we're moving forward. We have a plan, and we'd like to move to the next phase of that plan. We were not able to go any further with what we've done because the city didn't own it for 17 Hart Avenue at that time. It was in foreclosure, but that's been done now. The city has acquired the property. So the next step will be moving forward so that we can get the architectural renderings and the work started on the story of 17 Hart Avenue for what's being proposed. And that's going to, I guess, come for you as a resolution. We're hoping to have it on the docket tonight, which simply wasn't going to happen. So in a subsequent meeting, we'll be voting on a resolution that will, at that point, give over ownership of that property to the 6th Regiment to develop as new city headquarters as laid out in the proposal. We're applying, right as we speak, for the follow-up grant for our first planning grant to have. The next step is called an action grant. And the action grant allows you to implement the plan. It will be for $25,000. And that's what we'll begin to do our preliminary architectural design and what we can do within the $25,000 limit. I'd also like to point out that the Trenton Historic Society Board of Directors has authorized a donation of up to $1,000 for the purchase of the property. They further gave us up to $3,000 for signs that will be also part of the plan so that we can approach the cemetery with signage on outside and show you when and where it is. We've also been in conversations with the local blacksmith. So that's when the iron fences go up, he's going to make us a fancy little Locust Hill sign that's going to go over that. We're also working with various stakeholders in the community to erect a monument that will contain the names of all the people that served there. And Mrs. Wilkins' daughter, well, grandson, I want to say, is an Army, active duty Army soldier. And he is working on getting the Army, will be a veteran. They discovered that they're there. So he's going to be working toward getting the U.S. Army to get gravestones for the 10 to 14 United States Colored troops that are buried there. We imagine that we don't know exactly where it's grave they're in, so it's going to be a monument that contains their names in the names. Part of this plan, the last one. part of this plan includes the graveyard. The graveyard is basically in this area. We're not sure if there's any here. We're going to have to follow up into another stand to make sure. But this area, as it goes along the creek, is called the Savannah Garden. Accessible to anybody who goes along the walking path. We want a water feature here, something simple like a rock or stone with a waterfall in it. In the pool, we want to have that as a mineral pond where we will reintroduce native fishes that will be released back into acid concrete. We're asking that the people of the community each contribute a brick for the walking path around the Savannah Garden, and that neither in particular be contemplative space for anyone who cares to come and pray. The entrance to it will be there, on that side and on that side. Along the Oak Street side, we're planning to plant oaks. And on the Locust Street side, we're planning to plant black locusts, which is also a New Jersey native tree. We'll also hope to have here a flat area called an amphitheater, something like the Avenue Hill, where people can perform. It's nothing very expensive, but I think it's a great place for field teams to practice, concerts in the summer, whatever. Nothing very elaborate, but a place that they can do it along the walkway. We hope to use the walkway, the flow of the stream, the power generator that will provide light all along the path of the asset. So these are plans that the city has. That's shared with us and that we have tried to incorporate into our plan. So those are the overall outlines of what it is we're proposing, and it makes it for you. That's a resolution next month, I suppose, I'm not sure. And finally, what I have there is a letter from the city of Trenton that has expressed their support for the government's block project. So we have got to share whether we talk about a green project, the question is if the city is open to me, we have a better time. How do we know the office that expresses their support?
Thank you. I have spent many a weekend in cold weather and in hot weather on cleanup detail at Locust Hill. It concerns me that the surrounding community needs a lot of work, that we're going to have to work with the city on that. However, I want to thank you for your presentation and for your constant, consistent perseverance in restoring Locust Hill's territory and the surrounding community. And that not only memorializes the African Americans that were buried there, but it also makes this recognizable teaching tool for our children in the community, for visitors, and to that site. Being established in 1861, Locust Hill Cemetery is Trenton's largest, only remaining segregated black burying ground, containing the graves of approximately 76, I believe, individuals.
The numbers between 76 and 94.
I want to give a shout out also to your partners. Well, first of all, I want to give a shout out and thank the 6th Regiment of the United States Colored Troops and your team, the project development team, East Trenton Collaborative. So we talk about East Trenton, it's actually North Ward, the historic North Ward. So we really need to get Maria, our director of culture, natural resources, recreation, involved in this. We put the chief responsible for bringing proposals for this website. So these kind of collaborative, I go to their meetings, they do wonderful things, they really care about the community, and this is one part of the community that we really King Pins, the architects. So you have a good, you have a really, really good collaboration there with folks, and I would be happy if you need a letter from me as a North Ward councilwoman. I'd be happy to give a letter of support, and I'm sure that this council would be happy to support any efforts that you make. You know that everything is budgetary, Arjuna.
Thank you, Mark. Okay. We would appreciate any expression of support because that does help us when we apply to the state.
And I'm glad to see that you're reaching out and applying all these grants, and if you get the historic status, you will be able to do you more, and that's the best good for not to come to the city and just ask them for money that you don't have. But I think that we need to start looking at this because this is historic city. This is something that our kids and what concerns me about the educational system in the city is that we don't take our children and show them the history right in the back.
Absolutely.
They don't take the state house. We need to teach our children to live in the world out in the city to understand the history to respect their history and follow your precepts and everybody else's precepts to maintain that history and that pride. So thank you for the presentation.
Every marginalized expressions of support. It's really appreciated.
Brother. Mr. President.
Good evening, Mr. Alton Onward. Thanks for coming out and really introducing us to your project. All the stakeholders who have helped and contributed to this great effort and continue to do so. I just have really one question, and of course, this project certainly has my support, 100%. I just have a question around designation and why hasn't this historic cemetery has been recognized locally, statewide, and of course, nationally. And I just, since you've educated us and have had a mission that there is a significant number of African Americans who have served in the United States military. And it doesn't appear to me, but as I have heard it from you, but you can educate me, have the city, have we, in our borders, have we gone out? There is a congressional act. U.S. Congress in 1962 passed an act to designate, create cemeteries such as this that has buried U.S. soldiers, and they are as a nationally important cemetery, like Arlington National Cemetery, anywhere on U.S. soil where troops are buried should have a national designation. And I'm just curious, of course this will help out funding, but in order for these troops, this is in my opinion, and being that my father was a veteran of the U.S. military, and I'm sure so many others that sitting in this chamber and beyond, that there's certain designations that should be given for these folks who have sacrificed their lives for our country. And I see that there are, you presented letters from elected officials that recognize and have given their support, but I would personally like to see, as an American citizen, that this cemetery in my city should also be designated identified as a national treasure, right?
Well, I don't agree with you that it certainly deserves a recognition.
And, based on the congressional act of 1862, it deserves that designation. And the United States National Cemetery System, the United States National Cemetery System should act, should, I believe, we as a city should contact them if it, if it has not already been done. Has it been done? Or are there any plans to do so?
Don't know the answer to that. All I can say to you is that since the city has acknowledged the fact that there is indeed an African cemetery buried there and offered the, all the evidence, and the recommendation is to apply for the National Historic Trust as a historic site.
Historic National Trust historic site. Consider again, these soldiers deserve direction and recognition by their country.
Absolutely.
So I would again recommend strongly that someone on this project, the organization, yourself.
Thank you for what.
If I had to do it myself, I think that that cemetery over there should be reported to the national, the United States National Cemetery System and the Army National Military of Cemeteries. Because if you are reporting here today on the record to this council that we have men who served in the Civil War for this country, that we have not designated that, and we have not reported that to the United States National Cemetery System, then I think we, in their honor, we need to at least, at a minimum, do that.
I agree, Councilman.
And get that designation pursued to be compliant with the U.S. Congressional Act of 1862 and designating cemeteries that are have our soldiers who serve in any period war, you know, recognized and honored.
Agreed.
So I would appreciate, Mr. Ward, if you can at least do that.
We will make every effort to make sure that this is a fully recognized cemetery.
Again, my request is that you contact the United States National Cemetery System.
Okay.
Yep. At least notify them of the of what you have identified and see what they can do to make sure these soldiers are honored and given the recognition that they deserve.
I agree. And well, I just point out that I did mention that Ethel Wilkins' grandson, who is serving now, is working with us to get monuments for these soldiers that are buried there. So certainly, you know, I don't disagree with anything you said. And certainly we will take every effort to make sure that this is properly recognized. In fact, we joined a consortium of other African American cemeteries that are in similar positions to help us maximize our impact so that when we go to Congress for bills to do this, we can speak in a united voice. Dr. Stevens shared information with me that I found out and didn't know it existed, but there's an association of black cemeteries that have that mission as part of what they do. So certainly if there's a way that this can get better recognition, we're certainly in favor.
I mean, I'm all for recognition, but the highest recognition by any soldier who has served their country and died for their country is to be recognized by their country. So if there's deceased soldiers in, that, you know, in the cemetery, the United States National Cemetery System and the Army National Military of Cemeteries should be informed.
So you will.
Okay. So if you can get back to this council as to when you plan on doing that, I would much appreciate it.
Yeah, I'm going to do it straight away about council.
Thank you.
I just want to say, Brother Ward, thank you for your example for the Trenton community. You are highlighting the importance of history. There's a saying that the people without a connection to their history is like a tree without roots. And you are definitely connecting this city to its historical legacy, particularly the African American community. And I salute you. I thank you for giving the letter for me. Of course, that goes without saying. I will, you know, provide one. And I just thank you and the organization, the Color Regiment, since Color Regiment, Isles, the East Trenton Collaborative, I really think that this is important. Trenton has so much history that we have not properly engaged as an asset. And I just want to say thank you to you and the other leaders in this wonderful proposal. Thank you.
Councilman Reagan, thank you very much. Well, first, I want to say first that if there's any glory associated with this, I would like to make my sacrifice to God, because glory goes to God. And what I'm doing is simply serving the people around me in the best way that I can. You touched on a very important point. This is also, this mini museum and cemetery is imagined to be part of the overall historic tourism project. But what I mean by that is that we're looking at the Higley School, we're looking at the Locust Hill Cemetery, we're looking at the Carl Y as being somewhere, if you're an African-American or someone interested in African-American history, you have places to go in the city. And the Locust Hill Museum, you go to the Higley School, which we imagine being a much larger, more expensive museum, and the Carl Y, place that has a long storied history in the African American community of Trenton. So that we also want to link with the William Trent House, which has its own story about Africans who worked there during the years of William Trent, as well as the old barracks, is where African colonial soldiers spent some time. So the city of Trenton, to Durrell's point, has a rich historical legacy that we do not fully take advantage of, and that if you build it, they will come. We see thousands of people come for Patriots Week, and this is something that would be a great tourist attraction and income generator for our city. If there's no more questions, anybody else have any questions?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
Is that how it's going to continue?
Next on the agenda would be minutes for approval. There are no minutes for approval, so we will go on to communications, petitions, and reports. There are 15 communications, your petition, and one report from the city clerk's office. Being presented for your acceptance, it's a gravel application by, it's a Rough Life Rescue to hold a 50-50 gravel on February 22nd, 2020. Is there a motion to accept the communications?
So
second.
Moved by Mrs. Vaughn, seconded by Mr. Rodriguez. Is there any discussion?
Yes. Yes, I, Council President Rodriguez.
Yes.
Thank you so much. I just would like to say that this ordinance is broad. It takes out of consideration large groups of people in the city. And I think that there are some unforeseen circumstances. I don't think that the half-brother of someone with the Rent Stabilization Board should be precluded from working for the city. And if this ordinance goes into effect, it will ban people from having the opportunity to work with the city simply because they're related in, you know, various ways to people who are serving the city. And I think that if we are looking to hire Trentonians, there may come, there may be occasion where Trentonians may be related to people who serve on various boards and commissions. And I think that this, it might be motivated by a positive or a, you know, a good place, but the implications are just clearly, the implications can clearly be difficult or harmful to us attempting to recruit local talent. So that's all I have to say about that, and thank you.
Any further discussion? Ready for the vote? Mr. Blakely?
No.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
No.
Mr. Harrison? I'm sorry, it's not here. Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
And Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
The ordinance number 20-1 has been properly adopted and will be published. Provided by law. Next on the docket, the public hearing of ordinance number 20-2. This is an ordinance amending the Trenton City Code and Chapter 23, anti-fraternization policy. If anyone wishes to speak to this subject, please come to the podium, state your name and address for the record. Seeing none, is there a motion to close the public hearing? Moved by Ms. Caldwell Wilson, seconded by Ms. McBride. Ms. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. Newcomb?
Yes.
The public hearing on ordinance number 20-2 is closed. Is there a motion to adopt said ordinance?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Mr. Rodriguez, second by Mrs. Vaughn. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, you ready for the vote?
Yes.
Mr. Blakely?
No.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson? Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Mrs. McBride?
Yes.
The ordinance number 20-2 has been properly adopted and will be published in accordance with the law. Next on the docket is ordinance 20-6. This is an ordinance amending the Trenton City Code and Chapter 24, anti-harassment, anti-sexual harassment, and anti-bullying policy. If anyone wishes to speak to this subject, please come to the podium, state your name and address for the record. Seeing none, is there a motion to close the public hearing? Moved by Ms. Caldwell Wilson, seconded by Ms. McBride. Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Mrs. McBride? The public hearing on ordinance number 20-6 is closed. Is there a motion to adopt said ordinance? Moved by Ms. Vaughn, seconded by Ms. Caldwell Wilson. Comments? Discussion?
Yes. Thank you. So I would just say that you know, the intent of this ordinance is appropriate, but I think that it gives this council power that it does not have, you know, by statute, by Faulkner Act. It allows a council member to, or a council to remove a city council member, which is not in their purview, which is power that they don't have. I think that is very dangerous, you know, depending on where you sit on this council. You know, there are some pretty high tempers, and I would not want anybody's tenure on council to be decided by their peers. That's for the people who vote. And so for that reason, I'm going to vote against this, even though, of course, I am anti-harassment, anti-sexual harassment, and anti-bullying. But in this ordinance, it grants considerable powers to this city council that I don't think they deserve. I think this is another example of this council giving themselves power that they don't have. There are already channels to address harassment, sexual harassment, and bullying. will politicize, you know, investigations and adjudications. I mean, I just think the intent may be there, it's a good one, but the implications, particularly as I've been on this council for the last few months, I'm just really scared about the prospect of them deciding if I'm going to be your anybody. That's not their responsibility. So I just wanted to put that on the record. And I'm sure in the years to come, you know, particularly around the anti-nepotism policy, we are going to repeal this because I think they are going to harm the city in terms of recruiting people. So that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Any further comments? You ready for the vote?
Yes.
Mr. Blakely?
No.
Ms. Caldwell-Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Rashad?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Fulmer?
Yes.
Ms. Smith-Brown?
Yes.
Ordinance number 20-6 has been properly adopted and will be published in accordance with the law. Next on the agenda are public comments on new business only. That's comments for items that are on the docket as a resolution or ordinance for consideration by the governing body. Anyone wishing to speak on new business only, please come to the podium and state your name and address for the record. Seeing none, we will continue with the agenda. The next board council's consideration will be resolution number 20-23. Which is a resolution authorizing the open settlement of a workers' compensation claim in the matter of Sonia Wilkins versus the City of Trenton, claim petition number 2015-9964 and claim amount of $89,865.08, including attorney's fees and costs. Council President McBride has recused herself from this matter, so if the governing body wishes to have any debate on this subject, you're going to ask her to remove herself.
I'm
going to say maybe applicable for Mr. Blake. So is there anyone that would like to move the adoption of resolution number 20-23? Moved by Secretary Ms. Caldwell-Wilson. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Rodriguez. Ms. Caldwell-Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Rashad?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Resolution number 20-23 has been properly adopted. Next for your consideration is the consent agenda, which will contain resolutions number 2017-2020, 2024, 2038, 2040, and 20-42.
I resigned from both of those based on my employment with New Jersey Education Association. I'm a lobbyist now, Associate Director of Government Relations, and so in abundance, for an abundance of caution, I decided that it would be best for me not to have those positions. I'd like to say I had a really good time as a liaison. I think that the school board is, I'll just say it's quiet over there, which is normally not the case. I really have a lot of confidence in the superintendent and the school board, and as a graduate of Trenton Central High School and a former educator in Trenton Public Schools, it was my pleasure to serve in that position. And I wish the new folks who were in that position well, and I am sad that I have to resign from this position, but I have a good time while doing it, and I really believe that the Trenton Public Schools is headed in the right direction. Thank you.
In reference to us adding more money for the attorneys. And as I don't have a problem with having attorneys on board, the problem that I have is that when we go out to do a settlement and the body doesn't agree on the settlement, none of these lawyers that were paying $100,000 and $150,000 want to go into court. And when we pay this type of money out, these attorneys should be ready and prepared to go into court and litigate the case. Every claim that comes before us is not a claim that we're willing to just give. We want the city to use these attorneys that we are paid to go into that court and litigate and argue these cases, but we can't get that. And so I'm looking at all of this money that we're shelling out here again tonight, and I'm saying to myself, what are we paying for? What are we paying for? We can't get them into court to argue the cases. What are we paying them for? That's just my personal opinion, and I want to put it on the record. Thank you, Ms. Harris.
So is there a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented, excluding resolution number 20-14?
Second. President Bryan. I just want to say. Second.
Moved by Ms. Caldwell, seconded by Mr. Blakely. Mr. Blakely.
I just want to say to President McBride's point, if you look at the New York Times, it says that study finds that settling is better than going to trial. It says that the vast majority of cases do settle, from 80 to 92% by some estimates, and that is normal in the legal field that cases are settled, and that it would probably be more costly to the city if we were to engage in trial. So that's something to consider as we look at all these settlements. As one of our cases that we're considering in the fire department, we fight that, we're probably going to be on the hook for substantially more than we would if we were to settle. So, yes.
Swear.
Is there any further discussion on the body?
No.
You ready for the vote? Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Fuller?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
The consent agenda has been approved. Next, for your consideration, is resolution number 20-18. Which is a resolution authorizing the reopening of settlement of a workers' compensation claim in the matter Resolution number 2012-13796 and 2015-27381 in the claim amount of $101,180, including attorney's fees and costs. Is there a motion to approve Resolution 20-18?
Second.
Moved by Ms. Caldwell Wilson, seconded by Mrs. Vaughn. Is there any discussion? Are you ready for the vote?
Yes.
Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Michaud?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
And Resolution 20-18 has been properly adopted. Next, for your consideration. Well, actually, the final item already adopted this evening was resolution or ordinances being presented for first reading and introduction. Ordinance 20-7 has been withdrawn at the request of the administration. So that concludes all new business for the council consideration this evening. Next on the agenda for public comments. Please come to the podium, state your name and address for the record, and please keep comments to 10 minutes or less.
I want to go off this real quick. My name is Verita Logan. I live 21 U.S. Street in Trenton, New Jersey. That's a Clinton. The DJ district in Trenton. I had went to court yesterday. I had numerous charges on me in regards to the ordinance that you have here. This do not cover anything anymore in the city of Trenton. This is what was given to homeowners for parking in their neighborhood. I went to court for residential men, overtime parking, and residential men. I'm thankful there was a good judge in there who checked the ordinance of the city of Trenton. But what I'm coming in here for is to let you know that this doesn't cover anything anymore, since we have a kiosk, and the ordinance need to be changed. Because you have your, homeowners going to court, being charged.
Give that to Mr. Perry. Give that to Mr. Harris.
That would allow you to park in your neighborhood.
You're going to have to take this to Mr. McGrubby.
And I have to take it to you, too. And the charges from the court.
You can hand those to the court, to the court, Mr. Harris.
But you better get copies.
Okay, we understand that, but what we're trying to do is we're trying to see if we can get some copies of the information that you have so that Mr. DeWitt can take it to the law department and Mr. Monroe can deal with the law department.
You know, this lady sees me after the meeting, I'll give her my card to help her out.
Okay, all right. Okay, but we need to get copies of that. We need to get copies of that permit. All of that, Ms. Harris, we need copies of that. She needs to get over to the
department.
See Mr.
DeWitt
after the meeting.
Yeah.
Because this is not just to help you, this is going to help all of the residents that have that permit.
And there have been quite a bit of homeowners who want to quit in terms of
I'll figure it out.
Thank you. Thank you.
Is there anyone else from the public that would like to address the governing body at this time? Seeing none, we can move on to civic comments. Councilwoman Long.
No, I don't have any. Thank you.
Councilman
Councilman George Michaud.
No.
Councilwoman Marjorie Wilson. Councilman Jerome Blake.
I actually have a lot to say. I'm joking. Yeah, I'm done.
Ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate you. Your opinion matters. Thank you all for coming out.
March.